The following is a production of the Pentecostal Church of Sullivan, Indiana. Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Mike Fleming of the Pentecostal Church of Sullivan, Indiana. We want to welcome you to our program today. Yesterday was July 4th, and we want to sing some patriotic songs today. We'll present them in video form. We also have a message from guest evangelist, Brother Larry Flannery of Knoxville, Tennessee. It's going to be a great program. I know you're going to enjoy it, and I know you're going to be blessed when the presence of the Lord moves in your life. I trust it is a blessing to you. Right now, here's our first musical guest, Danny Norman, and he'll be followed by the Gaither Vocal Band.
There's a pine tree in the backyard, and he's swinging in the swing. Seems like just yesterday, but today he turned 18. Looks like his mama, got brains like his dad, just joined up in the army, now they shipped him to Iraq. Standing for his freedom and fighting for this land, he's got one thing on his mind: you don't take what I have, 'cause I'm an American through and through. I plead the colors of red, white, and blue. I'm an American, and this is where I stand, on the soil that my grandpa did fight for, as he battled through the Korean War. I'm an American. Years have come and gone. Now he has a son of his own, dressed up in his camel jeans, playing G.I. Joe on the TV screen, running through the living room with his big toy gun and his army boots, blowing up everything he sees with his Tonka truck and a hand grenade. Then he jumps from the couch to the chair like a missile flying through the air, screaming with everything he has, I'm an American boy just like my dad. I'm an American through and through. I plead the colors of red, white, and blue. I'm an American boy, and this is where I stand, on the soil that my grandpa did fight for, as he battled through the Korean War. I'm an American, still fighting for the good of man, sons and daughters, moms and dads, live or die, we're gonna take a stand, 'cause I'm an American through and through. I plead the colors of red, white, and blue. I'm an American, yeah, and this is where I stand, on the soil that my grandpa did fight for, as he battled through the Korean War. I'm an American. I heard him say, I'm an American. Thank God I'm an American.
Oh, say can you see, by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming,
whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
If tomorrow all the things were gone I'd worked for all my life, if I had to start again with just my children and my wife, I thank my God above to be living here today, for this flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. To be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to LA, there's pride in every American heart, and we gladly stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. God bless the USA. The USA.
Amen. Let's stand and give a warm Sullivan welcome to Brother Larry Flannery. Come preach the word of God without fear and without favor today.
Praise God. Amen. Give your pastor, his beautiful wife, a great big cheer. Would you do that? Give him a clap and a cheer. Amen. Thank God. Thank God for your pastor. Just remain standing with me if you can. Thank God for your pastor and his beautiful wife. And give honor to them today. Big Matt. Glad to be in service with them today. The Prince. Praise God. And all the great saints of God. Look at you. Look at your neighbor and say, ooh, you're looking good today. You're just looking good today. Oh, man. Praise God. Praise God. Y'all are looking good today. Good to see all the smiling faces. And great to be in the house of God. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 14. Now, the only thing that I can do is pour into you what the Holy Ghost has poured into me. And I don't think you would have me to do anything different. So, praise God. I will need you to grab hold and hold on from the beginning to the ending so that you can understand where we're going with this. All right? Praise the Lord. Proverbs chapter 14. Again, I'm very thankful to be with you. Verse 9, let's start there. Proverbs 14, verse 9. Anybody glad to be saved today?
Amen.
Praise God. Verse 9. Fools, notice this, fools make a mock at sin. Fools make a mock at sin.
Sure.
I was driving down the road the other day and I said, Lord, I apologize that my country that I love so much is so overrun with stupidity right now.
Right.
But I said, when flesh is ruling, that's what you get is foolishness. So here we go. Fools make a mock at sin, but among the righteous there is favor. The heart knoweth his own bitterness, and a stranger doth not intermeddle with his joy. The house of the wicked shall be overthrown, but the tabernacle of the upright shall flourish. Notice this. There is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. The Amplified says, there's a way which seems right to a man and appears straight before him, but its end is the way of death. Almighty God, we love you so much. We're so thankful for your mercy. We're so thankful for your grace. None of us would be standing here today without it, Lord. None of us would be standing here today without your love that you have bestowed upon us, your grace and your mercy that you have bestowed upon us. And may none of us here today take that for granted, God. Speak to us with your word. Give us an understanding heart that we may understand the scriptures this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone say amen.
Amen.
Give the Lord a clap offering before you sing it. Praise God. Amen. Again, you may be seated. Again, I want to talk to you. I want to talk to us for a few minutes today. What God has poured in my spirit for this service. And the Lord's been talking to me about a week about this service today. I want to talk about the way of man. Say that with me. The way of man.
Amen.
The way of man. Say that again. Just the way of man. We are certainly, unless you've been hiding under a rock somewhere and had your head in the sand, you certainly understand that we are in shaking times right now. We are in shaking times right now. And I mean, not overseas somewhere. It's always been, it kind of seems like for the last several years, and it's always been overseas. There's been wars and rumors of wars and all this stuff's been happening overseas. But it's the world right now, ladies and gentlemen. Have you noticed that? It is the entire world that is shaking right now. We are definitely in shaking time. And the Bible tells us that. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 12 that in the last days, listen to this, everything that can be shaken will be shaken in the last days. That's what the scripture tells us. So as Christians, we can't really be surprised or shocked because this whole world is being shaken right now. What we can be excited about is that scripture in Hebrews tells us that everything that can be shaken will be shaken, but we are a part of the kingdom. If you're in the church, you're a part of the kingdom that cannot be shaken. So we do have that to be thankful for, right? Are you glad? If you're not in the church today, you better get in the church with everything you got, because this is the only thing that's not going to be shaken in the end time.
Come on.
Shaken, man. This world is shaking. We did not think. Sister Fleming said it last night. Did you ever think that a few months ago you'd go to sleep and in America appeared to be normal, then you'd wake up and everything is shutting down and this virus is going crazy and the rioting and all this stuff that's happening? We are in shaking times, ladies and gentlemen, and I have to ask myself and I have to think, how close are we right now to eternity? How close are we right now to the coming of the Lord? How close are we right now to standing before God and giving an account for the life that we have lived here on this earth? And I have to look at you and ask the same question, but I have to turn it around on me, and I have to look at me, and I have to say, am I ready to stand before God and give an account for the life that I have lived on this earth? Am I ready? Am I ready? I know how to put my suit and tie on, and I know how to look good when we come to church, but is there anything in my heart right now that's not ready to stand before God on Judgment Day? Is there any bitterness or unforgiveness or any hatred or anything that I'm holding on to from my past that I cover up well, but it's hidden there? It's hidden there, but am I ready to stand before God? Because it's not going to be hid anymore when I stand before God. Isn't that something? Oh, help me, Jesus. When I come to church, I can stand before the church. I can stand before the preacher while he's preaching, and I can have things hidden in my heart. But when I stand before God on Judgment Day, I'm not going to be able to hide anything, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be out there. Right? Ooh, how close are we right now to eternity? Why are we in shaking times? This is why we're in shaking times. Jude tells us in Jude chapter 1, Jude tells us why we are in shaking times. Jude 1:17. Let's look at this. Jude 1:17. Let's look at this. Y'all going to give me just a little bit of time? Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Jude 1:17. But beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before of the apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to this. How that they told you that there should be mockers in the last time. Notice this. Who should walk after their own lust. They be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. The Passion Translation says there'll be mockers in the last time, and they will be motivated by their own ungodly desires. These people, listen to this, see if this sounds familiar. These people will cause divisions. They will cause division and confusion because they follow their own natural desires and instincts. Jude, in verse 11, Jude called these people that would manifest themselves in the last time. He said they're going to go after the way of Cain. Jude, in the New Testament, talking about the last days, reached all the way back to Genesis to pick up Cain. And he said there was a spirit that was manifest itself way back in Cain that's going to come back to life in the last days. And these people are going to go after the way of Cain. What's the way of Cain? The way of Cain was pride. The way of Cain was haughtiness. It was, I'm going to do it my way. The way of Cain was, I know what God said and what my daddy taught me how to bring a sacrifice, a blood sacrifice, but I don't want to do it that way. I'm going to bring the sacrifice that I want to bring. So Cain was about haughtiness and pride. It was the way of man. Somebody say the way of man. Cain was a restlessness under the restraints of virtue. He didn't want to be told what to do. Didn't want to be given instruction. Didn't want to be given order. Don't want to be told what to do. Want to take down order and take down. Does that sound familiar? Defund this particular department of order and law. Does that sound familiar, ladies and gentlemen? That's the way of Cain. I want to do it my way. I don't want to be told what to do. Don't anybody tell me what to do. Jude calls them in verse 13. He said they're going to be raging waves of the sea. They're going to foam out their own shame. They're going to be wandering stars to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Lost in eternity forever because they chose to go their own way and they chose to do it their own way. In verse 16 he said these people that's going to manifest in the last day, they're going to be murmurers and complainers. Notice this. And they walk after their own lusts. Murmurers and complainers, and they walk after their own lust, and their mouth speaks great swelling words. Oh my Lord, the Apostle Paul put it like this in 2 Timothy 3. He said, know this also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Notice the very first thing he says about the last days in 2 Timothy 3 in verse 2, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. Somebody say selfishness. Somebody say the way of man. Men are going to be lovers of their own selves. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. Come on, I ain't got time to preach on every one of these things. But if you've been paying attention, all of this stuff should be jumping off the media at you right now. All of this stuff, you ought to be saying, yeah, that's going on right now. We're seeing that on television right now. And I'm not talking about coming out of Hollywood. I'm talking about coming out of politics, our own politicians and our own leaders. And it's happening on the streets right now. Hello, somebody. Unthankful. Unholy. This is the way of man. This is the way of man that's going to manifest itself in the last days. Unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Paul goes on in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2 through 4. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove and rebuke and exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Listen to this. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Here, listen to this. But after their own lusts. Now, wait a minute. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Who will not endure sound doctrine? Christians, or quote unquote Christians, people that sit on church pews, will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own selfish desires, they will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn, listen, Christians shall turn away their ears from the truth, and they will be turned into fables. The Passion says it like this: for the time is coming when they will no longer listen and respond to the healing words of truth. They will no longer listen and respond to the healing words of truth. Let me have that Bible. That, ladies and gentlemen, this is the healing word of truth right here. This is the healing word of truth. If you need to be set free, you need to listen to truth preached. If you need to be healed, let the healing word of truth penetrate your heart and your mind. Oh, God's word is still real. It's still true. It still heals. It still sets free. It still delivers, but not people that won't hear it.
Come on now.
Not people. people that won't hear it. They will turn. They will no longer listen and respond to healing words of truth. Listen, because they become selfish and proud. They will seek out teachers with soothing words that line up with their desires, saying what they want to hear. They will close their ears to truth and believe nothing but fables and myths. Did you ever think you would be in a time, in a day and an age where you would hear a phrase spoken so much? It's called fake news. Have you ever think we'd live in a time where you don't know what to believe anymore coming across? Because you've heard so much fake news. Did you realize that was Jude talked about that? Paul talked about that in Timothy. There would become a time when people would want to hear fake news. They would desire to listen to fake news. What's so troubling about this, ladies and gentlemen? He didn't say they would backslide. He didn't say they would leave the church. He didn't say they would say, all right, we're just going to go live for the devil. We're going to go party it up and live for the devil. No. He said, after their own selfishness, they would say, no, preacher, we don't want to hear Acts 2:38 no more. We don't want to hear Jesus' name baptism no more. We don't want to hear holiness no more. We don't want to hear righteousness and separation no more. So we're going to go get somebody to tell us what we want to hear out of this book and tell us we don't have to do the other stuff. They're not going to backslide. They're going to keep coming to church. They're going to keep saying we love you, God. They're going to keep singing the songs of Zion. But when it comes to the healing word of truth, they're going to say, no, don't tell me that. I want you to tell me thus and so that I'm all right living in my sins. It's fake news. It's fake gospel. It's fake grace. I heard somebody say the other day, listen. And this is the mindset of the last days. And this is the way of man. They said, it is not a lie as long as you believe it's the truth. I'm going to let that marinate for just a minute right there. It ain't a lie if you believe it's true. So where does that end at? I mean, how far can you go with that? Nothing's a lie. Then nothing's a lie. Hello, somebody. I mean, you can actually believe he's tall, dark, and handsome if you want to. I don't care. It's not a lie. It's not a lie. You believe it's true. And they went on to say, listen, preacher, listen. There's your version of truth and there's my version of truth. And so they said, you believe your version of truth, preacher, and I believe my version of truth. And I read another post. I saved it on my phone. And it was a very popular movie star type person. I'm not going to tell you who it was. I'm not even going to mention the name. But she said, I am a Christian. I am a Christian. And I refuse to let anybody tell me I'm not a Christian. But I do not believe that all of the Bible is real, and I do not believe that all of the Bible is true. But I am a Christian. I don't believe you have to go to church. I don't believe you have to do this and that, but I am a Christian. I said, that's fake news. That's fake gospel. If she just could tell me, how do you know you're a Christian if you don't stand on this Bible right here? Because I feel this way or I feel that way. Listen, the most deadly thing we can give place to is our feelings. Your feelings and your emotions can destroy you. They will destroy you if you don't line them up with this book right here. Fake news. Fake news. Fake gospel. It's not a lie if you believe it to be the truth. That's what he said was going to happen in the end day. There are going to be churches full of people that do not hear and respond to the healing word of truth because they're selfish. So they're going to close their ears to the truth and they're going to believe a lie and believe a fable. You believe a lie and you believe a... Oh my God, I got to be careful here. You believe a lie and you believe a fable. That's self-deception, ladies and gentlemen. That's self-deception. Proverbs, in our text in Proverbs 14, fools make a mock at sin. Fools make a mock at sin. The passage says fools mock the need for repentance. Fools mock the need for repentance.
We don't hear that no more. We don't hear that preached anymore. Nobody preaches repentance anymore. Nobody preaches repentance anymore because we don't need to repent. I'm doing all right. I'm doing it my way. I feel good about it. I don't believe God would do thus and so. I don't believe God would judge this or judge that. I don't believe God's a loving God. He's a loving God. He's not going to be displeased with me because He loves me. And He knows I'm just flesh. And He knows I'm just going to do this or I'm just going to do that. You know what that tells me? You don't read your Bible. You don't read your Bible. You don't listen to your Bible. You don't know anything about the Scripture. You're just going on feelings. Fools make a mock at the need of repentance. You don't need to repent if there's no need. If you don't, Jesus.
Oh, preacher.
I don't say much. I haven't said much about all this stuff. Online, you know, you get on Facebook, you can't argue with flesh. You can't argue with flesh. You can't debate with flesh. You can't do it. God Almighty can't argue with flesh and debate with flesh. That's why He said flesh has got to die. Hello? But they started all this dumb stuff about defund the police, do away with the police. I said, all right, yeah, that makes perfect sense to me. I mean, I understand. Listen, you got to follow me now. You got to follow me because I'm going to show you, I'm going to help you. I'm going to explain this to you. And you're going to understand this because this is going to make perfect sense. We got to defund the police department. We need to get rid of all police because the only reason we have crime is because we have cops. If we didn't have cops, we wouldn't have no crime. We need to get rid of all the fire departments and the fire trucks because the only reason we have fires is because we have fire trucks. If there wasn't no fire trucks, there wouldn't be no fires. We need to get rid of the hospitals and the emergency rooms because the only reason we have emergencies is because we have emergency rooms. No emergency rooms, no emergencies. We need to get rid of all soldiers and military because the only reason we have war is because we have soldiers. If we get rid of all soldiers, we get rid of all wars. That makes perfect sense to me. Doesn't it make sense to you? I'm going to go a little bit further. The only reason we have sin is because we acknowledge there is a God. No God, no sin. No God, no conviction. No God, no repentance. So I say we just say, God, get out of our business and let us do it our way. Oh, now y'all tracking with me now, right? It don't make no sense at all, ladies and gentlemen. It's about, that's the way of man. The way of man makes no sense at all.
Come on.
But man says it looks right. Ooh, there's a way that seems right. There's a way that looks good. But it's leading me to destruction because it's the way of selfishness. It's the way of self-righteousness. It's my way. Yes, I'm going to do this my way. I'm going to live for God my way. I got news for you, ladies and gentlemen. Ain't no living for God your way or my way. It's His way right here. It's His way. This is not a democracy. This is a theocracy. There's one head. There's one boss. You don't get a vote and I don't get a vote. You're going to live for God, you're going to do it His way. And this is His way right here. And He does not operate outside this book right here.
Right.
Woo! Fools make a mock at repentance. Verse 12 in the passage. Am I okay, y'all? Y'all stay with me because it's going to get good in a minute. You can rationalize. The passage says you can rationalize, and that's what flesh does. You can rationalize it all you want to, and you can justify the path of your error and your sin that you have chosen, but you'll find out in the end that you took the road to destruction. He said, and that's what flesh does. Flesh will rationalize and explain away and justify its response. Flesh will rationalize and explain away and justify what it's doing because it looks right and it feels right and it sounds right. And so I'm going to do it my way. Oh, but you don't understand that your way is the way of destruction. He said, this is the sign of the end time, is a spirit of selfishness. And Pastor got on it a little bit a while ago, and we talked about it a little bit yesterday, but that people's all running around saying, God's in charge, God's in charge, God's in charge. That tells me people don't read their Bible very much. God put man in charge in the garden. Man failed in the garden. Jesus come back to the garden, and Jesus took control and authority back and gave it back to man by way of the church and told the church to go have dominion and occupy until they come, and the church is walking around all fumbling and stumbling around. But flesh is in charge in this world. That's why we're seeing what we're seeing. Because man is saying, hey, God, need you. We don't need you. Man's in charge. That's why they can close churches down but leave abortion clinics open. That's why they can close mom and pop stores down but leave the liquor stores open, because flesh is in charge. Flesh, 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 flesh is in charge, and flesh is ruling, and flesh is man's way. They're separating themselves. In Jude and in Timothy, Paul said in our text, in Proverbs, man in the end time is going to separate himself from God. He's going to choose his own way. He's going to choose his own way. And some of those men are worldly, unrighteous, sinful people that's never known God. They're going to choose their own way and live their own way. Some of those people sit on church pews, and they are going to choose their own way and the gospel that they want to hear over the full and true gospel, separating themselves, doing their own thing. But Jude doesn't stop there. In verse 20, he says, But you, the way of man, but you. Notice verse 20. But you, beloved, build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. He said, listen, people are going to separate themselves in the last day. They're going to choose their own way, their own desire. They're going to choose how they want to live for God. But you, beloved, you need to constantly and progressively build yourself up in the Spirit. You need to build your faith up. You need to be praying every moment in the Holy Ghost. You need to be praying every moment in the Spirit. Oh, not just on Sundays and Wednesdays, not just on Bible study night, but we need to be praying and walking in the Spirit 24/7, 365. Oh, my God. It's a fine line. I'll be walking right here. It's a fine line. I'll be walking right here. But I'm going to walk a little bit and then we're going to get out of here. All right? But I travel this country enough. I preach enough places, enough churches. This is what I love about this. You're going to have to catch a little sarcasm. If you don't catch it, you're going to miss the whole thing. But I'm glad we're not responsible for anything. See, we're not responsible for anything. This is the way of man. This is the way of Christian men and women. We're not responsible for anything. It's either all God, God's fault, God did it, God allowed it, blah, blah, blah. Or the devil's doing it, the devil did it, the devil allowed it. I'm so glad my choices don't mean nothing. And my decisions don't mean nothing. I don't have no responsibility here. It's either all God or it's all the devil. Bunch of baloney right there. Woo! Oh man. 95, 98, let me just keep going. 96, probably I'm almost be a 97% of the time, or of the issues and the problems and the dilemmas that most of the, probably all, 99% of the people sitting on church pews are dealing with, is not devils and demonics and spirits. It's a flesh problem. It's a flesh attitude. Flesh is holding on to unforgiveness. Flesh is holding on to bitterness. Flesh is holding on to hatred. Come on now. I don't see devils with with anybody in headlocks. I don't see chains on nobody. But I've seen hurt. I see hurt feelings that people are holding on to them things. Now, the devil's a master. He knows how to poke that flesh. He knows how to poke that flesh. When I'm whining and feeling sorry for myself and pouting, ready to throw in the towel, that ain't the devil doing that. Come on, y'all. That's his carnal mind. That's his carnal nature. And the devil does know how to poke that. But my Bible's telling me I need to poke back. How do I do that? Praying in the Holy Ghost. I got to walk in the Spirit. I got to quit walking in this carnal mind and start walking in the mind of Christ. Start walking in the Holy Ghost. Build myself up constantly. Build myself up progressively. Praying in the Spirit. Building my faith up. Praying. Right. Some of us in this room right now wouldn't be dealing with some of the issues we're dealing with if we was praying in and walking in the Spirit all day every day. Come on now. It's a mindset. Carnality is a mindset. The flesh is a mindset. Walking in the Spirit is a mindset.
Preach, preacher. Amen.
You might hurt me. I'm just going to use you for example. You might hurt me. You might hurt my feelings. You might have wounded me. You might have stabbed me in the back. You might have betrayed me. But you can't make me hold on to it.
Right.
Nope. I got to choose that.
It's a choice.
I got to choose that. That's flesh way. Jeez. Somebody, well, I can't do it, preacher. I can't do it. I hear that all the time. I can't do it. I can't let go. I can't lay it down. I can't do it. I can't do it. My flesh is weak. I understand that. I do absolutely understand that. And so did the Lord Jesus Christ. He understood that. That's why he went to the garden and he said, God, I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't drink that cup. Let it pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And he submitted himself to the will and the purpose of God. Why? God knew you couldn't do that. That's why he gave you the Holy Ghost. That's why you got the power of his spirit living on the inside of you. So that anything come against you, you don't fight it with your flesh. You don't fight it with your carnal nature. You fight it with the power of God.
Glory.
Build yourself up praying in the Holy Ghost. Build yourself up. But you, people are saying, I'm almost done. People are separating themselves. They're going the way of man. They're going the way of man. They're going the way of flesh. They're going the way of selfishness. But Jude 20, but you, beloved, build yourself up in the on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. You, beloved, in verse 21, you, beloved, people are walking away. People are walking away, sitting on church pews, and they walk away. Paul told Timothy earlier, reprove, rebuke, and we read it to you. I didn't carry it, but I read it to reprove, rebuke with all long-suffering and doubt. Do you know how hard it is these days for the preacher to get up and have to do any reproving and rebuking when everybody's got their feelings on their cuff?
Mom.
Who do you think he is telling me to do that? But I'll tell you who he thinks he is. He better think he is that. He's the man of God that God put over this house to lead this church. But everybody, you look at him. I'm just about to the place where I'm just going to start walking up to people and say, all right. Is there anything? Do I offend you in any way? What I'm looking, what I'm wearing, does my name offend you? Do I offend you in any way? I apologize. No, I'm just like, people's looking for some way to get offended. It's in the church. It's in the church. I didn't like that song. I'm offended. I don't like what they're wearing. I'm offended. I don't like how they did that. I'm offended. I don't like that. I'm offended. I'm going to take my ball and go home. I'm going to suck my thumb. I'm going to sit back here and pout. I'm going to make everybody know that I don't like what's going on. I'm going to let everybody see the selfishness. But I'm drawing attention to myself. Woo, help me, Jesus. I want everybody to look at me and know I don't like what's going on. Jude went on and said, listen, keep yourselves in the love of God. You gotta build yourself up praying in the Holy Ghost. He said, what was your name? Carrie? Woo, Carrie. They made a movie about you, Carrie. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Carrie? How old are you? How old are you? You're all right. Look at me. Listen. You know how you were up here at the altar praying and stuff long ago? Praying and the Holy Ghost was all over you. The Spirit of God was all over you, strengthening you and touching you and stuff like that. That's what you need to do all the time. You can do that in your prayer closet, in your private time. You're strengthening yourself. You're building yourself up. You're making yourself stronger. Your faith is stronger. You're making your spirit stronger. You don't have to wait till Sunday morning to do that or Wednesday to do that. And that goes for every one of us in here. That's what Jude is saying. We're in this last day and people are going crazy. Man is going crazy. Flesh is going crazy. People don't want their own way. Do it their own way. But he's saying, you children of God, I'm almost done. You child of God. Don't look at that. Don't listen to that. Build yourself up. And you go, verse 21, and keep yourself in the love of God. Keep yourself in the love of God. You got to keep yourself. Oh, did you hear that? Did you hear that? Did you hear that? Did you catch that? I'm almost done. Did you catch that? the major sign of the last time is they're going to be going after their own selfish way. They're going to be going after self. He goes down here in verse 21. How do you take care of self? How do you keep self under control? Keep self in the love of God. Keep self consumed by the love of God. Keep self covered by the love of God. So today in our close, I felt this morning when I got here. I thought, God, well, I'm praying, you know. Where are we going with this today, God? What do you want to do with this today, God? How are we going? It would be awesome. We don't have a shout and service. It would be awesome to do all those things. And I kept hearing the Lord say, self-examination. Self-examination. Every one of us today, as we stand together, we need to examine ourselves today. It would be easy for me to look at you or for you to look over at me, but today we're going to look at ourselves. Am I walking in the way of man, after the way of man, which is self, which is flesh, my way, I'm going to do this my way. God ain't going to tell me what to do. Preacher ain't going to tell me what to do. If I don't like what he's saying, I'll go find somebody that'll tell me what I want to hear. Are you, am I, walking after the way of flesh, the way of man, the way of flesh? The way of flesh holds on to hurt and pain and bitterness and anger and depression and discouragement. The way of flesh walks in fear. The way of flesh. Or are you and am I walking in the Spirit? Are we walking after the Spirit, keeping ourselves in the love of God? Because the love of God lays hurt and bitterness and anger and depression on an altar and leaves it at the feet of Jesus. The love of God refuses to hold grudges. The love of God says it's all about you, Jesus, and not about me. The love of God says I'm willing to abandon everything at the foot of the cross. That's what the love of God says. That's what the love of God says. Every eye is closed. If you're able to come up here and pray for a few minutes, I want you to come and pray. You can stand or kneel or whatever you do. If you're unable, you can just sit and kneel over. Yeah.